Good morning, and welcome to CSIS. I'm Steve Morrison. I'm Senior Vice President here at CSIS, and I head our Global Health Policy Center. We're very fortunate today to have here with us four distinguished experts on international drug policy. I'll introduce them in just a moment. I want to offer special thanks to Catherine Streifel for helping organize this, along with Joe Jordan and Alicia Kramer, Carolyn Schroat from CSIS. Michael Hahn from the Department of State was very helpful in coordinating and making it possible for this particular event to work in Ambassador Brownfield's schedule. So thanks to all of you. Let me say a few words about our speakers. You have in your laps their detailed bios. I'm not going to go into a great length. I'll just hit the high points on their bios. What were the flow that we're going to follow this morning. After my brief remarks, I'll invite Ambassador Brownfield to come forward and deliver the keynote opening of his overview of U.S. policy on international drug control. That'll be the starting point for the discussion that will follow. After that, I'll invite all of our other speakers to come join us here on the dais for a roundtable discussion. I promise you we'll try to get to you as quickly as possible to solicit your comments and questions from the audience. We are slated to go up until 11:30. One or another of our speakers may have to hive off slightly before that, so don't be dismayed by that. Ambassador Brownfield is the Assistant Secretary for International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs. He's been in that position for over 3 years now, so has considerable longevity and experience in that. That's a terribly important bureau to be heading in terms of combating illicit drugs and organized crime and providing extensive programs in law enforcement and rule of law. The budget's in that portfolio over $4 billion a year in 80 countries administered by over 5,000 employees. He came to this position having served successively as ambassador to Colombia, 2007-2010, critical period in the U.S., what's generally regarded as a successful program there, a partnership with Colombia in control of drugs in that period, an extensive program. Prior to that, ambassador to Venezuela and to Chile. Thank you, Ambassador, for being with us today to help put this program forward and to start off with a statement of U.S. policy. Ruth Dreyfus, former president of the Swiss Confederation, is with us today. She served from 93 until 2002 as a federal counselor in parliament. She was head of the Federal Department of Home Affairs, under which public health, social insurance, scientific research, higher education, gender equality fall. And this was a critical period also in the social policies undertaken and harm reduction initiatives and others that we'll hear more about. She served in that position until 1997, and during 1999, she served as president of the Swiss Confederation. And as we'll hear in a moment, she's been a very active member, along with Michelle Kazakhshin, in the Global Commission. Dr. Michelle Kazakhshin is the U.S. Secretary General's Special Envoy on HIV/AIDS for Eastern Europe and Central Asia. He is a close friend and ally and known to many of you here. He has been at CSIS repeatedly and has been a partner in programs undertaken here, undertaken in Paris, undertaken in Geneva. Prior to this position, he was Executive Director of the Global Fund to fight AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis. Prior to that, was President Chirac's Special Envoy on infectious diseases, on HIV/AIDS and communicable diseases. Before that, headed the National Agency for Research on AIDS in France. He's had the most distinguished career spanning several decades and is a widely regarded expert on the issues we're treating today, but also more broadly on the whole spectrum of HIV/AIDS, TB, malaria challenges. Dr. Kevin Sabet has come up come to join us today. He has written, studied, researched, spoken widely about drug policy, drug markets, and drug prevention. In 2000, he served in the Office of National Drug Control Policy in the Clinton administration. 2003 and 4, he was a senior speechwriter in the Office of National Drug Control Policy under George W. Bush's administration. 2009, 2011, was a political appointee and policy advisor under President Obama's administration in the Drug Control Director's Office. So quite a remarkable career path, arc to his career in serving in three separate administrations. In 2013, he founded with former Congressman Patrick Kennedy the Smart Approaches to Marijuana. We'll hear more about that. Given what's happened lately in the legalization of recreational use in Colorado and in Washington State, this has triggered an entire new national debate. I see many of you here in the audience who have contributed to that debate. Kevin has been a major voice in thinking through what some of the implications are in the long and the short terms. The policy that we're talking about today, an international drug policy, encompasses many different considerations, and we'll hear about those. In the search for the most effective means to accomplish quite complex and diverse goals. It means focusing upon enforcement, upon the reduction of illegal drugs, including challenging in a holistic way very powerful criminal organizations, and to shape the demand side in consuming societies. It means focusing upon minimizing the harm that illegal drugs cause people and aware that prevention and treatment of addiction, a powerful brain disease, is formidable, it's essential, it's complicated, it's an evolving science and evolving field. And it means sustaining very effective and active diplomacy that leverages our partners, governments, international organizations, NGOs, societal groups. And that cooperation is being tested, as we'll hear today, continuously, especially as we see new synthetic psychoactive substances coming onto illegal markets. Our four speakers bring quite different perspectives, and we'll hear about that. We are at a moment of big debates here and beyond around what international policy should look like into the future. We are in the midst of multiple transitions. We're in the lead up to the 2016 UN Special Session on Drug Policy, the first such gathering in 18 years. An historical debate is underway. It's evolving about the existing three UN drug control conventions, which has been the basis for decades for international action. And the question that's on the table is, what, if any, changes and reforms are warranted? What should they be? What is the evidentiary basis? And what's the political will that's going to be required to move those forwards? We'll hear from Ambassador Brownfield how these issues are being debated out in the UN Commission on Narcotic Drugs, which just met in Vienna in March, which will meet at a high level in 2015. And that effort, the UN Commission on Narcotic Drugs, will be essential, will be pivotal in shaping the debate at the 2016 special session. There's a parallel effort underway that we'll hear more about, too, from Michelle and from Ruth, the Global Commission on Drug Policy, which is an independent initiative founded in 2011 with active support of many prominent former heads of state and others, President Cardozo, George Shultz, former Secretary of State, Secretary of Treasury, and an esteemed economist, Paul Volcker, Kofi Annan, and others. And these two very active members of that commission, Michelle and Ruth, will talk to us more about how they are pressing for a rethinking of approaches to criminalization, and pressing for new models of legal regulation and greater emphasis on public health treatment and prevention approaches. Obviously, this is a period of very big change. We're at the end of a decade of efforts to control opium and heroin in Afghanistan. We are at the end of a remarkable period of achievement on HIV/AIDS, which points us now, as we think about the ends of AIDS, to reaching those special populations, including injection drug users, who remain populations of high incidence in Eastern Europe and elsewhere. And as I said earlier, we're in a period in our own country of a transformation happening, the legalization in Colorado and Washington, and a great deal of turbulence and uncertainty around what happens in this next phase. So all of these things come together here in some fashion, and it makes really for a quite dynamic moment in debate that we're in the midst of. So please join me in welcoming Ambassador Brownfield to kick us off here today. Thank you.
Kick off.
Another sports term, kickoff.
Thank you. Great stuff. Thank you very
much. Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Steve. Dr. Morris, Madame la Présidente, Joyeux,
We'd like to hear one person's opinion and observation. As Dr. Morrison suggested,
you flip it however you wish. Ladies and gentlemen, as Dr. Morrison kind of suggested, if some of you have been asleep for the last 15 or 16 months, you may have missed this, but there is a fairly significant debate, a national debate, a global debate that is going on right now in terms of drug policy and how to deal with the matter of dangerous drugs in our future. Here in the United States of America, two states have voted in referendum to legalize one of those drugs, cannabis, and 18 more states plus the District of Columbia permit some degree of medical use of marijuana. You no doubt are hoping to hear my opinion on this. You will not, because I do not have any greater right to an opinion on our domestic drug policy than does anyone else in this room. And you will articulate your views, I am quite confident, in a few minutes as we begin some dialogue with you. I am, however, that person that you, the American taxpayers, pay to manage our international engagement and participation in this issue. And that field I will address in a few brief minutes of comments this morning. Ladies and gents, there are three international drug conventions that guide the international community in this matter: the 1961 Single Convention, the 1971 Expanded Convention, and the 1988 Convention Against Drug Trafficking. The United States of America is a party to each of these conventions and has, unusually in the last 25 years, ratified each of these three United Nations conventions. May I tell you, as a law school graduate, although not a lawyer, these are actually quite well-drafted conventions. They're very precise. They're very tight. The lawyers in the room who agreed on the text did a fine lawyerly job in drafting these conventions. They have a precise number identified of drugs on their prescribed annexes. And I might note that marijuana appears in the annex of the most tightly restricted of the drugs. Their authorization for medical use of drugs, and particularly marijuana, is very tightly prescribed and controlled in the conventions. And the conventions explicitly and expressly hold national governments responsible for the conduct, if you will, of the entire nation, including provincial, state, municipal, or local governments that form part of the larger nation. The conventions create two international oversight bodies. The policy-making body, as Dr. Morrison just mentioned, is the Commission on Narcotic Drugs, or the CND, and the organization that is designated as that responsible for ensuring compliance and adjudicating interpretations of the conventions is the International Narcotics Control Board, or INCB. The INCB, let me start my story, has been taking a position on the United States of America and its position on marijuana for several years. They have expressed views for more than 3 years on those states which now permit medical use of marijuana, and beginning last year began to express views on two states, Washington State and Colorado, which through referenda legalized the use of marijuana for recreational purposes. In October of last year, I had the pleasure of joining a small U.S. delegation which went to Vienna to articulate the U.S. government's case as to why, in our judgment, we were in compliance with our international treaty obligations, even in light of the decisions by Washington State and Colorado to legalize the cultivation, production, sale, possession, and consumption of marijuana. Our argument went something like this. The purpose of the conventions is to accomplish the objective of controlling, discouraging, reducing the use of potentially dangerous drugs. The conventions, we argued, allowed a substantial amount of discretion to the individual governments on how they would accomplish those objectives. The convention specifically offered, by way of exceptions, those countries whose constitutions required a different approach to the objectives, to allow them to continue with their constitutions and not have to change their constitutions in order to comply with the conventions. And our argument went, it was the right of the United States government to determine how best to use its limited, and in some cases scarce, law enforcement and criminal justice resources to best accomplish the objectives of the conventions. And therefore, we said, we were in compliance with the conventions. About a month ago, the INCB, in its annual report for 2013, begged to differ, reached a different conclusion, and while they were not definitive in their judgment, because technically they were judging the year 2013, prior to the moment when the Colorado and Washington State rules went into effect, they nevertheless assessed that the argument by the United States government was not sound. That said, I have read Article 2 of the United States Constitution. I am aware of who I report to, and may I go a step further? I'm actually quite comfortable with our argument. I actually think we are correct, we will continue to articulate this position. About 4 weeks ago, slightly less, I believe, the Commission on Narcotic Drugs held its annual meeting or conference, the CND. I had the pleasure of being the co-head of the U.S. delegation to that meeting as well. While we had many engagements, a great deal of discussions, at least three public presentations, I would argue that we were trying to develop international consensus on some basic points that could guide the United Nations and the international community as it wrestles with the issue of adjustments and changes to drug strategy, drug policy, and drug conventions in the years ahead. I laid out four basic pillars in my conversation. Pillar number one, defend the integrity of the conventions, the three conventions. Why? First, they've been around for about 50 years, and speaking as a dinosaur who has been in this business for 35 years, while it is possible to correct an old document, it's a lot easier to adjust it than to completely create a new one. I would draw your attention to the fact that our governing document here in the United States of America is about 225 years old, and we have somehow found a way to move from 1787 to 2014 without having to trash the original and create a new one. So pillar number one, integrity of the conventions. Pillar number two, flexible interpretation. If it is a living document, if they are living documents, living means you are allowed to adjust your interpretation as the world changes around you. The world in 1961 was a different place from the world in 2014, and we, the governments and member states of the UN system, should be permitted to interpret with that degree of flexibility as we move into the 21st century. Third pillar or principle, tolerating different national strategies or policies. There are 194, I believe, countries represented in the United Nations today. Each one has its own approach, its realities, its strategies and policies to deal with drugs and the consequences of those drugs. Some degree of national differentiation in policy has to be accepted and even permitted. And the fourth pillar was, the argument that whatever your position might be on legalization, all 194 governments should agree that those transnational criminal organizations who traffic in the substance for the purpose of making money, corrupting organizations, laundering proceeds through in an illicit manner through financial systems of other governments should be resisted, combated, and ideally eliminated. Integrity of the conventions, flexibility of interpretation, toleration of different national policies, and combating the organized crimes. May I suggest to you that my experience in Vienna 4 weeks ago suggested that there is good hope for consensus built around those four pillars, allowing among the 194 different governments, those that feel strongly that the policy should be very strict and prohibitionist, and those at the other side who argue with equal strength that in fact we should substantially lessen the criminal penalties and restrictions on drug use and drug consumption, that I saw prospects for being able to get all of those countries to unite under those four basic pillars. That's my international presentation, ladies and gents. Now, one of you no doubt is saying to himself, well, what would be the best policy for the United States of America to pursue that would give me the strongest chance for actually building or holding some degree of international consensus on these matters? Thank you for asking that question, and I will, in fact, provide you an answer, and through that back door, get to the question of, so what about Washington State and Colorado? Ladies and gentlemen, here domestically, there are two issues at play. Call them issues, call them principles, call them areas of disagreement. I don't care what we call them. There are two things out there, to use the technical term. And what you're about to hear reflects to a very considerable extent words you have heard from the President of the United States and the Attorney General of the United States, which puts me, in my opinion, in pretty good company. Principle number one, marijuana is a harmful substance. It is toxic, it is addictive, or if you prefer to argue about addiction, let's say it produces dependency, but it does have, if used in sufficient quantities and sufficient regularity, the impact of requiring the same human to use the same substance. We, society, the communities, the nation, the planet, want a policy that not only does not encourage, but discourages its use. If we can discourage the use and consumption of alcohol, nicotine, caffeine, fatty foods, and sugary drinks, surely we can have the same degree of societal interest in discouraging the use of cannabis and marijuana. Second principle, it is not in our nation's interest, or quite frankly, I assume any nation's interest, to populate its prisons and to overburden its criminal justice system with large numbers of people for the simple offense of possession or consumption of marijuana. It is not just a criminal justice problem. It is also a public health problem. And if we can somehow develop consensus in this nation and perhaps in the larger world that brings these two principles to bear. Principle number one, cannabis is harmful. We want policies, rules, laws, processes, and procedures that discourage its use. And principle number two, we do not wish to fill our prisons with people whose sole offense is that of consuming the stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, as your paid, and not particularly well paid, representative who tries to articulate the U.S. position in the international community on drug policy, may I suggest to you that that approach, those two principles, give me something I can work with in the international field. Please don't ask me to negotiate and find consensus among 194 governments on the planet for new conventions. I will tell you in advance, I am not smart enough, I am not passionate enough, I am not patient enough to deliver that sort of consensus. I seriously doubt I can even deliver you 67 members of the United States Senate to ratify any new convention. You may have a different position and a different picture than I do in terms of how swiftly and with lightning-like celerity the treaties of today are moving through the United States Congress. My own view is I myself cannot offer you a great deal of optimism on that front. We are in a time of opportunity and transition. Transition produces change, and change can be good. But it is good, ladies and gentlemen, only if we do it right. And I look forward to working with you and hearing from you on just how we can do it right. Thank you very much, Dr. M. Back to you.
Thank you.
Will I stay right here?
Please, yeah, just grab a seat. If you guys could come up. Can we get some water up on the table, please?
Exactly. I mean, collapse.
Just go over here. Good. Right over here. Right over
me
steps.
There?
Steps.
Oh, okay.
I think you should. I think you should.
No, no.
May I?
I'll sit in the middle. And you, why don't you sit
right
here?
I'll sit at the back. I think that. I think President Grayford should be right here. I insist. J'insiste.
Volontiers.
We'll have some water here in a moment. I've asked Michelle, Ruth, and Kevin to think ahead. We had a general idea of what Ambassador Brownfield was going to present to us today. I asked each of them to come prepared with a few minutes of remarks around how they, from where they each operate and think about these matters. What would they add to this conversation? And I'm going to ask Michelle to kick things off. I'll ask Ruth Dreyfus to follow, and then we'll come in with Kevin. So, Michelle.
Thanks, Steve. Are we switched on?
Yes.
Yep. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ambassador Brownfield, for those introductory remarks. I must say, being here as a member with Ruth of this Global Commission on Drug Policy, our view is not that the debate is around whether the conventions should be renegotiated. And I did not expect that debate to happen in Vienna a few weeks ago. What I was expecting in Vienna and what I did not see happen in Vienna was what was originally the purpose of that meeting, which was a review of the progress made in the in what people call the world's drug problem. And I haven't heard that review. And I haven't heard from you an opinion on whether the US considers that globally, we, with the policies we currently have been successful or not in dealing with the world drug problem. So the way the Global Commission is looking at this is not about the frame, the conventions. I think none of us really believes, as you said yourself, that you know it's worth entering the debate of renegotiating a convention. We believe that there is enough space within the conventions for flexibility, as you also said. But we believe the important thing is to ask ourselves, are our current drug policies, which in most countries of the world are based on repressive law enforcement and prohibition law enforcement, is that the right way to do? 3 years ago now, the Global Commission published its first report, which everyone can get outside the room, called The War on Drugs Was Lost. And that report was really about our view, our analysis, that what happened in the last 40 years, despite the original intentions of the convention, is an overinterpretation of the conventions towards a repressive law enforcement view that has been predominating in most countries as the basis for policies. And what has happened in the last 40 years is that actually consumption of drugs has increased. Drugs have become cheaper, more available. Now with the synthetic drugs, more drugs are coming on the market every day that anyone would be able to control and to add to the annexes on the list. And repression has been as harmful, if not even more harmful, than the drugs themselves. So that's our starting point. From there, we have been coming with a number of thoughts that we can develop in the conversation. And the first, and you know, coming from me with the background that Steve provided to you on what I have been doing so far in my life, the first is that people's health is to come as the highest priority. Why do we sign a convention? Why do we elaborate and design a policy as a government to protect the people's well-being and health? And what has happened is that harsh penalties and harsh repressive policies have had tremendous negative impact on people's health. The fear of arrest, the fear of incarceration is driving people who inject drugs underground, as you said, Steve, in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, in actually throughout Asia, and now in many places in Africa, as we discover. People are driven underground, they inject in unsafe conditions, and that drives a huge HIV epidemic. One in five of the estimated 13 to 15 million people who inject drugs worldwide are infected with HIV. It drives a huge epidemic of hepatitis C, a silent epidemic. And again, I'll not go on with publicity for our reports here, but you'll find two reports of the Global Commission, one called How the Criminalization of Drug Use Fuels the Global HIV Pandemic, the other is on the Hep C pandemic. And also, not to forget tuberculosis. If you are a person injecting drugs and you're incarcerated today in Eastern Europe, let's say in the Russian Federation or Ukraine, your chances of acquiring TB is like 26 times higher than in the general population. Our second point after, let's say, people's health should come first is stop incarceration and stop dealing with this issue through criminal justice. So that's what people call decriminalization or depenalization. But basically what it means is remove sanctions under criminal law with the optional possibility of going to administrative sanctions. But remove that from criminal law. And as you said yourself, reduce incarceration. There are figures that you know better than I do about the US of you know, up to 50% or so people incarcerated for reasons that somehow are linked to drug offenses, and very often minor drug offenses, and actually use or possession. Whereas the big traffickers, those who I agree we need to combat fiercely, you know, somehow escape the system. Our next point would be about regulation and replace prohibition with regulation, because prohibition just doesn't work. It didn't work with alcohol, as you know well in the US. Regulation is somehow something that enables societies to more effective control of what we're doing. So I'm not saying we're very good worldwide at fighting tobacco or alcohol, we're even worse, but at least we know what we do when we regulate. And some of the experiments, let's call them that way, that will happen in Colorado, in Washington State with marijuana, will teach us, I think, good lessons about where the weaknesses can be, but where the advantages can also be of regulation. So our starting point is that prohibition just doesn't work. Prohibition doesn't prevent people from using drugs, and has not. And prohibition has actually led to repressive policies that themselves have been harmful. So prohibition does not reduce consumption, but we believe prevention does. And I'm sure you'll agree with that. We're all agree with this, that we're insufficiently scaling up prevention interventions. And finally, where I would certainly agree with you is that, you know, one size doesn't fit all, so that it isn't that the Global Commission is proposing a universal new model. We're just saying, again, let's open an honest debate, not an ideologically charged debate. Let's open an honest debate. The policies that we have been pursuing in the way we have been interpreting or over-interpreting the original intention of the conventions have not led to a decrease in drug consumption. They have led to repressive policies that have had huge negative consequence on the health of people and on the safety and well-being of people. Think of the violence in Latin and Central America. So we have to question whether that was the right way of doing things, and that's what we're doing with the Global Commission.
Thank you. Ruth?
Thank you. Well, I have little to add to the presentation of our aims in the Global Commission. I just want to stress how happy I was to listen to you, Ambassador, in Vienna and here, because I think there is a big change in the United States of America and on the international scene. For many, many years, the US were really for a strong interpretation of the convention without possibilities of flexibilities. And I can speak about that because as a country, as a responsible for public health in a country that was pioneering new methods of treatment, of prevention, and of harm reduction, I had quite often the impression that not only Vienna, not only the international bodies, but behind them, the US were very critical about what we did in Switzerland. So just let me tell some words about my experience as a former Minister of Public Health, responsible for the implementation of the drug laws in my country, which is a chance to have the Minister of Health being in charge with that and coordinating all the activities and not the Ministry of Law Enforcement is a chance. It was a big chance at the beginning when we were really confronted with a peak in the HIV/AIDS epidemics, and where we were also confronted with an explosion, I would say, of consumption among people who were totally disintegrated, not marginalized, discriminated, and gathering in some places where the police had pushed them in order to protect other neighborhoods from the harm of their presence. So we had really to enter directly to accept the visibility of the drug issue and to enter into a strong contact, a close contact with the people, not only the person who are consuming drugs, with drug addicts or people who were just consuming in a non-problematic way or not yet problematic way, perhaps these substances, mainly heroin, but also the contact with the neighborhood, the contact with the families. We were really asked by all the environment to help the people not to die, to help the people not to be contaminated with lethal diseases. And that was the obligation we had coming from the ground, coming from the concerned people, to adapt our policy, our public health policy, but also the collaboration between all the people, all the stakeholders of the drug policy, including the police, the justice, and the city administration, and so on, in addressing the problem. So we had to develop, for instance, a larger scale of treatment. Treatment only aimed for abstention are not possible for many people. Many people are just not able to follow or not able to stay clean after having had such a treatment and being in greater danger after the treatment than before because their body and their attitude has changed and they cannot afford to have such strong and often of very bad quality drugs they find in the black market. So we had to extend the substitutions therapy, even still supporting also abstinence-oriented treatment, that's sure, but to have a large amount of people in substitution therapy. I know that some of your former drug czar came to Switzerland, very interested in our methadone programs in that time, General McCaffrey. But we had also to look if some people who were not complying with the offer we could, the services we could offer, needed other kind of treatment. And so we introduced heroin prescription, legal heroin prescription for the people, a very small number of people, but people who were just not being able to follow other treatments. And the results, monitored by a scientific team, a mixed scientific team for many years, these results were very encouraging for the health point of view, but also from the criminal point of view. The petty criminality drug users often have to follow to be able to buy the substance they need. And the reintegration, coming back to places where they could live normally, coming back even to job integration. On the other hand, we knew that we couldn't touch all the people, even if in Switzerland, I think it's a good figure, we have between 70 and 80% of people consuming drugs being in treatment. I think it's one of the highest figures in the mm-hmm. world because of this large spectrum of services mm-hmm. offered. But we knew that we cannot touch all the people, so you have to protect also the people who are not in a treatment program. And this was the development of harm reduction. I know that in the US, perhaps you have a little bit another comprehension of the world harm reduction we have in Europe. In Europe, it's really a whole battery, a whole spectrum of services that help the people to protect themselves. It includes clean syringes, clean needles, but also, for instance, safe consumption room where the people can come with drugs they bought in the street, I mean on the black market, but where they can consume in a safe environment and have perhaps the first contact with people working on the social and health dimension to help them make, perhaps, they are free to do so, but offering first possibilities of steps toward treatment and a better life. So this whole spectrum was still criticized in Vienna, still criticized as something that was too brave to be honest, if I can say so. But I think it makes cool. I mean, it's an example, even considering that we could really give scientific evidence about the result of this new policy. I think it helped to change also the position in many other countries in Europe. Now, other countries are pioneering new models of decriminalization. Switzerland is not a pioneer in this field, but Switzerland had never incarceration for just for consumer and possession for their own consumption. But I mean, we have now other countries in Europe that are making experiences that are interesting, and I would say, in contradiction with some of your papers I read, I think Netherlands and Portugal decriminalizing the consumption of all substances in Portugal, of cannabis in Netherlands, has seen no increase in the consumption, no greater public health problems, and no greater criminalistic problems in the country. I think Portugal, for instance, could correct some perhaps explosion at the beginning of the dictatorship of consumption and really regulate now the relationship between the states and consumers, inclusive recreational consumers, offering them a whole range of services they can accept, but without criminalization of what they are doing. Now, just let me finish with one remark. I think everybody can agree with your four pillars. They are very reasonable. And the necessity is not only to agree on these pillars, but to allow a real discussion about the advantage and the failure of the system. And this is still lacking, as Michel said. And it was a delusion in Vienna to see that the people who wanted really an open discussion were just blocked by those who didn't want to chat, wanted to continue to taboise, to have a taboo on this topic. And I think our duty as member of the Global Commission is really to open this debate, because I cannot accept one point in one direction. When you say that tolerating different national strategies is a necessity, I'm very happy to hear that from your mouth, because I think it will open the possibilities and flexibilities. But if this means that in some countries, people who are using drugs have no access to treatment, people who are in certain countries are forced for constrained treatment with labor force, for forced labor activities, for instance, and with brutal ways of bringing them off their consumption. If I see that that people in prison are, have no possibility to protect them, knowing that in each prison you cannot guarantee that there will not be drugs, and you have to protect the inmates more than you protect the people outside the prison, because you are more responsible for them and more responsible for giving them the means to protect themselves. If I see such kind of application of the convention, if I see that in some countries pain relief medicine are not ordered by the country, you know, the country has to announce all the imports they are doing on the substances on the list. And if I see that some countries are just not ordering, not importing the means they need to help people against awful pains, cancer people, ill people, and so on, I think that there is a real harm produced by a strong, harsh interpretation of the convention. And in this sense, I cannot accept and tolerate that national strategies are violating basic human rights, and they do.
Thank you. Kevin, thank you for being so patient.
No, thank you for inviting me, and Madam President, thank you for your remarks, Michelle. Ambassador Brownfield and everyone here, I appreciate everyone being here. I think we have multiple points of agreements, actually, more than might be led on in terms of opiate substitution therapy, in terms of access to health, in terms of denouncing barbaric practices done in the name of treatment, like the labor camps we're seeing in Southeast Asia, like the treatment of drug users in former Soviet countries and in Eastern Europe. And certainly in the idea of scaling up prevention and recovery services. I mean, unfortunately, when you do a survey of especially community-based prevention versus just sort of scare tactics, few countries around the world are employing community-based prevention. So I think we agree with those things, or I do. Where I think I find trouble is that I think in this debate often we do not have a clarity of terms that we use. So very general terms are thrown out and used, and they're interpreted by different people to mean different things at different times. And it really muddles the debate. So drug policy is a difficult thing. It's not anything that I think can be characterized by a term on a bumper sticker, whether that term is just say no, a war on drugs, or whether that term is legalize it or regulate it, to use that language instead. I think it's much more nuanced than that. And as a result, I don't think we do a service to the debate when we throw around some of these terms and they're used by very different people. So the example of alternatives, when we talk about alternatives, I think we need to be very specific about what we mean and what geographic areas when we're speaking about alternatives. And I was happy to hear some of the specifics today, but when I read the Global Commission report, I found it very hard to disagree with the premise of the 80 to 90% of the report, which talked about how we need a health-oriented drug policy, how people whose only crime is using drugs should not be incarcerated, how we need to focus on prevention and essential harm reduction services. The problem is oftentimes many people agree with that, and then we will jump to what I would call drastic conclusion as a result of that, which I think it's very drastic and extreme, especially in the US context as we see the commercialization of cannabis being rolled out day by day in Colorado and soon Washington, to say that the result of those problems or the logical conclusion of those problems should be regulation or legalization. When I think that we at least owe it to ourselves to try less drastic measures, because once we go and fully implement legalization, I think it's going to be very difficult to turn back. And when we see global prevalence, as you mentioned, Michelle, of alcohol and tobacco, alcohol basically being used by 7 times as many people in the world as cannabis, and tobacco cigarettes by about 5 times as many people in the world as cannabis, let alone the other illicit drugs, which would be something like on the order of 10 times as much tobacco users as cocaine users, and about 20 times as much for alcohol versus the other drugs like heroin. I think that would be that is very dangerous to make that logical sort of overstep, I guess, and overreach. When it comes to terms like decriminalization, I even think we should be very clear about what terms, and I appreciate you bringing that up, because I think, at least with the US, which are the statistics I'm most familiar with, when we look at the people who are in prison, whether it's state or federal, and just to clarify the statistics, we have about half of people in federal prison are there for drug charges, the overwhelming majority in federal prison for drug trafficking, over 99% in fact for drug trafficking on the federal side. State side is where we have more people with lower level offenses, and we have about 1.4 million. But even stateside, an analysis done in the Clinton administration, redone in the Bush administration, and we redid it in the Obama administration, found it very difficult to identify more than 6 or 7% of people in state prison whose only crime was low-level drug possession, not just marijuana, drug possession, that by far the majority had been diverted to treatment or something like a drug court, which actually, they did enter the criminal justice system as a result of being in a drug court, but then they quickly exited it as a result of having that kind of treatment with accountability. And actually, if you look at most of people who are in drug court, and actually most people who are in the U.S. system with drug charges, they are in there with other charges. I mean, it wasn't as if they were a perfect angel, and the only thing they did that the law enforcement person frisked them and found a little bit of cocaine, and they were now sent to 10-year mandatory minimum. They often had other charges and crimes, either as a result of trying to finance their habit or as a result of being under the influence of drugs, that accompanied that charge to even sort of alert the police in the first place. I think we have to really look very closely. Now, that's very different in the U.S., and this leads to my other point, than around the world when we look at geographic variation. I mean, certainly in, disturbingly, large amount of countries, we do have people, as you mentioned, we don't have to name, you named some of them, but, in certain parts of Eastern Europe, in Russia, in Southeast Asia, where we do have people essentially rotting away with, unfortunately, with addictions that are left untreated, with spreading a disease within those systems. And I think we need to come down against those in the strongest and the harshest possible way. And I join you with that. But I think we need to be careful to confuse sort of one region of the world with another. Furthermore, this distortion of terms, or I think sort of overuse of certain terms, I mean, I saw that when the Organization of American States did their report, the Summit of the Americas, of which I was, I think, one of 30 people on the writing team for that. And of course we mentioned things like regulation and what was going on in Uruguay. I mean, you wouldn't want to ignore a significant development that's happening around the world and also in the US. But the headlines and the way that certain lobbying groups ran with that, if you didn't read the report, you would think that it was essentially advocating for global legalization. And when Ambassador Simons talked about the report in Vienna, some of us were at that side event, many of those special interest groups were livid that at the end of the event, the word legalization wasn't mentioned once by the Organization of American States, by Ambassador Simons or others, because that wasn't the crux of the report, and yet that was the way that certain groups, I think, tried to spin that. I've seen that spin also in the discussion of Portugal. I mean, when I look at Portugal pre what they did, I see a relatively homogeneous small country that never really arrested users before, okay? Just like Switzerland and the Netherlands didn't. Now changing formally to a policy of essentially, if you have a small amount of drugs, you don't just get off scot-free necessarily, you are in front of a three-person social worker panel that includes a lawyer, and they determine what happens next. We've seen, I think, mixed things as a result of that. I have, the Eurostat, which comes from EMCCDA and other groups, have shown an increase in use. They've also shown decrease in some of the things that we're happy that there were decreases in, like drug-related deaths. I think it's difficult even to tie that policy change with anything significant either way. And I caution people on my side of the fence on this not to, sort of over-interpret what happened in Portugal as, unmitigated disaster, worst thing ever, but I think folks on the other side should probably be more cautionary in their statements. And I guess that leads me to saying that I don't think that the choices, this is what I believe for cannabis in the U.S., but also all drugs worldwide, that our choices between a repressive war on drugs, which has played itself out in nefarious ways around the world for the last 40 years, and legalization or regulation. Again, I think that there's much more in the middle to deal with a problem that is tied with security issues, that's tied with education and the level of education that a state provides its citizens, that's tied with the level of healthcare that a state provides its citizens, the level of security that a state provides its citizens, economic opportunities. The idea that something as simplistic as, well, we can regulate so that we can, for example, remove the cartels that are, of course, now involved in multiple things way beyond drugs, or as a way to increase health, when I think we have much better ways to increase health, I think is a false argument. And then I guess finally, just to end one on the cannabis issue, as it was brought up, I think what's going on in Uruguay is very interesting. I don't think it's really relevant for the U.S., just in terms of the way that our American-style commercialization tends to play itself out, unfortunately. I mean, you might have seen the Washington Post last week that talked about the new, you know, national cannabis industry lobbyist who's here full time. I don't think there was a lobbyist in Switzerland for heroin-assisted treatment that was, you know, lobbying you, Madam President, and getting paid $500,000 a year to do so. But in the U.S., we tend to want to do these things, and that's, you know, should be expected here. And I think what should further be expected is the further commercialization. And if we instead, I reject the term that this is an experiment, because when you have an experiment, you have something that is controlled, that you're looking closely at the data, that you have data systems in place, that you analyze the data, and then you learn from there. What we're doing in the U.S. is 1,000 miles an hour across the country, being fueled by big money and people whose commercial interest it is to increase addiction. Again, I'll repeat that. It wasn't in the Swiss government's interest to increase addiction so that you had more people come for heroin-assisted therapy. Unfortunately, here, it is in the interest of people to increase addiction because that's how you increase profits. Of course, we know that the tobacco and alcohol industry thrive off of addiction because a small amount of people consume a vast majority of the volume of those substances. And it's the reason why during your U.S. visit, you go to Las Vegas and you look at the person, you know, betting $100 at the blackjack table, I guarantee that person does not have the free penthouse suite at the top of the, you know, on the top floor, that instead the person that, you know, risks his life savings, you know, every other day on the craps table, that person probably does have the penthouse suite because it's in the interest of the gambling community to, you know, and the businesses to increase and encourage unhealthy use, encourage. So when Ambassador Brownfield talks about policies that discourage, which I think all of us are in agreement, we want policies that discourage use, that discourage risky use, that discourage needle sharing, all these things, that unfortunately the U.S. style of the way we're going, and you can see the early reports for yourself in Colorado, is not down a path of trying to discourage use. That instead we have companies who will live off and thrive off of encouraging use, the exact opposite. So, I guess finally, just in terms of this global, I do agree, Ambassador, that there's a global debate. I think we have to be though sincere about who that debate is among, because if you look at the public opinion polling, even in Uruguay, I mean, even where they are going for marijuana legalization, even after a year of a government-sponsored campaign to convince people that this was the right way to go, and there was a media campaign to that regard, still in that country, I think it's something like at least 65% of people opposing the policy. When you look at Guatemala, Colombia, Mexico, other countries that, you know, many of us here in think tanks in DC think, well, yes, logically they want to stop the violence, so they want legalization. When you look at those public opinion polls, we're seeing upwards of 70, 80% opposition of even cannabis legalization. So I think the debate is among elites, not among people in those countries, and I would hope that, you know, that elites and former presidents and others who are talking about alternatives, that we can truly have a debate about alternatives as opposed to something that I think is a false dichotomy of status quo, drug users rot in prison, HIV, hepatitis C levels off the wall, labor camps, forced prison labor, or something like legalization and regulation. I think we owe it to ourselves to have a clearer debate and to discuss the alternatives in the middle that don't put us towards the path of the global disaster that is alcohol and tobacco legalization. And the reason there's not a global consensus to reverse those policies is simply they have been ingrained in our culture globally for a very, very long time. Predates the drug conventions, certainly predates all of us up here. So we sort of let that one go. I would hope that we wouldn't, you know, let, you know, the cocaine issue go or even the cannabis issue go. That instead we can have a more intelligent discussion.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank all of you. I'm going to come back to Ambassador Brownfield for his thoughts, and then we're going to open the floor to you. And when we do that, some of my colleagues will bring a microphone to you, and what we'll do is bundle together three or four comments at a time. I know Kevin needs to depart at about 11:20. We'll try and come back to you and hear from you before you have to jump off. What I heard was a remarkable level of consensus and agreement around fundamental principles, pragmatism, being smart, moving ahead in a very complicated picture, balancing off quite complex competing priorities, and pressures. I also heard an appeal for a more critical review in the process, in the C&D process, for more open debate, for more precision of terms. And I think, Kevin, I think you were very eloquent in saying, beware, be careful, have your brain open, your eyes open as we move ahead and think about what some of the consequences are in terms of politics and commercial interests and public health. Ambassador Brownfield, would you care to give us some of your thoughts and reactions to this, and then we'll move to hear from the audience.
Sure. Not much to add, mostly because I want to give Kevin a chance to take a couple of questions, and I happen to know he's going to be departing within the next 5 to 10 minutes. Ladies and gents, here is what I think we have both heard and what I think is the reality in the world today. We are talking about a debate or a discussion that has been going on in some way, shape, or form for 40 years. It has been dominated for most of those 40 years by the two extremes. At one extreme, we have those that I would call the strict prohibitionists, who say, do not give an inch or a centimeter on this particular issue, up to and including make this a criminal justice program and problem and solve it that way. At the other extreme, we have the equally simplistic, in my personal opinion, legalizers who say, if we just legalize the stuff, the entire problem will go away. Voila, just like that. Legalize on Monday, it's all gone by Tuesday. And I often wonder, and thank God that that's not their approach on murder, homicide, robbery, and other such crime. Now, my argument, and I believe what we're kind of hearing, although several may not wish to associate themselves with me, is we've got to find the sweet spot, the target, somewhere in between those two extremes. We are, in fact, moving the debate away from this simplistic debate of the last 20 or 30 years. We have to legalize, we have to prohibit, into figuring what would be the appropriate ways to proceed. The world is changing. Medicine, science, criminal justice, all of these things have changed since 1961. Of course we're going to review what we're doing. Of course we're going to review what is the best way to accomplish the objectives that we as communities and societies wish to advance. I not only am not uncomfortable with where we are in the United States today, as well as where a number of other governments are, I think it's actually a very good idea. If I might quote the President of the United States when he left the Summit of the Americas in Cartagena in 2012, I think he said, and I think I quote, we welcome the debate. He actually didn't say we agree with those who are taking these positions, but he said, we welcome the debate. This is actually what helps us move in the right direction. But Kevin says it exactly right. And it's a different way of saying what I said at the end of my presentation. Folks, change is good, but let's make sure it is good change. It does no one any good if at the end of the day, in order to produce change, we produce an outcome that is actually as bad as, if not worse than, what we have right now. That's my pitch. Back to you, Dr. M. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. So let's take some comments. We're going to bundle together several. Why don't we come, if you could come down, Chris, to the front. We have Keith and Martin here, and then in the front row. And please identify yourself. Be very succinct. One intervention, please, not multiple, because we'll go Keith, second gentleman here. There's a woman here in the front. We'll do four, and then we'll come back, and then we'll do another cycle. Thank you. Keith?
Thanks, Dr. Morrison. Keith Martin from the Consortium of Universities for Global Health. Thank you so much for your wonderful comments. The science is there. No better place to look at it than the National Institutes for Health, NIDA, and Dr. Nora Volkow. The scientific evidence is there. So, Ambassador Brownfield, you asked us for a solution, something you can pursue. That's consistent with the convention and the objective of the U.S. administration. Dealing with addiction, if you were to be able to take an exemption and to be able to adopt something like the North American Opiate Management Initiative, which is a drug substitution program, in combination with dealing with the social determinants of health, because you know these are complex problems, use that as an experiment, use that as an example in some of the key areas in the U.S., and you will show the leadership and the effect that you're trying to achieve. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Howard Woldridge, retired detective and co-founder of LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Just want to say that my experience as a street cop, the war on drugs, prohibition, has been the most destructive, dysfunctional, and immoral policy since slavery and Jim Crow. To Ambassador Brownfield's point, the only thing legalization does, sir, is end the violence and crime associated with the drug trade. It has nothing to do with drug abuse and use, but it will destroy the drug trade as Al Capone was destroyed in 1933. My concern is for children. Every day in this country, we have millions of children in gangs. The government reports a solid 1 million are employed today as drug dealers. Every day, 7, 8 or so are shot dead. This is shameful. This is immoral. Does anyone on the panel, especially Mr. Sabet, have any strategies on how to eliminate this job option for our children who are getting shot and killed every day, and at a maximum and a minimum, joining a gang involved in illegal behavior? And last, does anybody know any benefits to Mexico on American drug policy? How is it helping Mexico?
Thank you. Yes, please.
Thank you. Sue Thaw, CADCA, Community Anti-Drug Coalitions of America. Just 2 points that I'd like to discuss. The first one is, yes, definitely, this is a public health problem, but it's very difficult to deny that when people beat their wives, domestic violence, people getting killed in car accidents because they're driving under the influence of drugs, that it's not also a criminal justice system. So the question is, how do you adequately deal with this in both systems, not try to pretend that somehow this is not also a criminal justice issue? And the second thing has to do with youth and social norms. We're seeing in Colorado and Washington the perception of risk, actually throughout our whole country among youth, is declining because of the debate about legalization and medical marijuana. Kids do not think it's dangerous. And we're starting to see the rates go up, but we've actually seen gigantic declines in the perceptions of risk and social disapproval, which if that happens worldwide, I think we are going to see these issues turn into alcohol and tobacco. Thank you.
Thank you. Right behind you, if you could just hand it to the gentleman right behind you. Yes.
Hi, Dan Riffle with the Marijuana Policy Project. We drafted Colorado's legalization law. Question for Dr. Sabet. President Obama was recently asked about the relative harms of marijuana and alcohol and said that marijuana is no more harmful than alcohol. Project CM immediately put out a statement criticizing the president. Nevertheless, you've said before that marijuana is in fact less harmful. Former Congressman Kennedy said on CNN later that week that he agrees with the president that alcohol is more dangerous. So I'm curious if you could explain why, even though marijuana is less toxic, less addictive, and not associated with violent behavior, it's inappropriate for the president and other thought leaders to acknowledge that.
Okay, can we just hold? Let's take one more down here, gentlemen. Chris, if you wouldn't mind.
Yeah.
And then we'll come back to our speakers, and I'm going to let Kevin lead off since some of these are directed specifically to you, and we are under some time pressures. Yes, sir.
My name is Gregorio Meraz. I'm correspondent for Televisa News Network, and I would like to ask Ambassador Brownfield what he thinks, what is his assessment of the drug on the war on drugs in Mexico? In the last 6 years, we have seen an amazing number of people dying because of that. Do you think this war on drugs helped somehow, or just allow the cartels to get more power, because we have not seen before this firepower of the cartels until the last 6 years, I mean, during the Calderon administration. Did it help somehow to control the war on drugs, or it was just a waste of money? In the other hand, what do you think is going to be the message of the legalization of the drugs, the marijuana in Colorado and Washington state for Mexico, who has been suffering terrible violence due to this problem?
Thank you, sir. Kevin.
So a couple things. Sorry, I'm just requesting my Uber to take me to the airport, so I wasn't texting and I wasn't planning any questions in the audience. No, a couple things. I think those are all good, valid concerns. I'll just take a few. I think one on the drug and the gang problem that you rightly point out, Howard, I think that we clearly have not done enough in with the issue of economic opportunities, education opportunities, healthcare opportunities in those communities where you are more likely to be a member of a gang or a street gang. And in fact, when we look at the alcohol model, if we're trying to fix problems in urban areas, I think that would be the last model we would ever want to look at when we see that, for example, there are 8 times as many liquor stores in poor communities of color in this country than there are in upper class white communities. And that's simply because you go after vulnerable populations who are vulnerable to increased use and addiction and don't have the resources to write a $50,000 check to the Betty Ford Treatment Center if there's a problem. And so I would never want to use the alcohol model for anything, especially if I was interested in social justice and public health. Secondly, even under a legally regulated market, and this may get more to what you're saying, unless you're going to make the, for example, the price of crack cocaine, the cost of production, and legal for anyone of any age, which would mean a 10-year-old hit of crack would be about 3.5 to 5 cents to produce, and which you don't want to do. So unless you're going to do that, which you're of course not saying, you are still going to have that underground market. The question is, how do we reduce that underground market and manage it? A lot of communities actually have done it through innovative law enforcement practices like the Drug Market Initiative that's been in over a couple dozen cities in this country that goes essentially does offer those job opportunities to low-level dealers rather than incarceration, gives them a second chance. It has not displaced crime, but it has actually reduced crime, and it has at least driven the dealing that has been going on to an indoor environment as opposed to a more publicly noxious outdoor environment. I think we have to get to the fundamental issues in those areas, and the idea that, well, we can just go ahead and legalize it, and then therefore these gangs, so we won't have the million people in gangs, et cetera, I don't think that's the case at all, because you're going to increase demand under legalization, the price is going to drop dramatically, and you're still going to have an underground market to sell to the people that we're not willing to sell to in a legal market, i.e. those under 21 or those that have, you know, problems with illicit drugs. On the issue of alcohol versus marijuana, I mean, I get that people have a problem with inconsistency because, to say, well, wait a minute, beer causes me to be violent and marijuana causes me to be sort of chill, so why are we encouraging beer use versus marijuana? I really think that that is a major logical fallacy to essentially say, my right arm is broken, i.e. alcohol policy, and we got to live with it, and therefore, I want to break my left arm in order to be consistent. And I think that's the sort of akin to the argument of alcohol policy is here to stay, and so, well, you know what, we might as well treat pot like alcohol. I think that's it's totally the wrong way to go. And especially when we see the damage of legal alcohol and the damage of an illicit commercial industry. I also think in terms of specifically the president's remarks and also Congressman Kennedy's and my own remarks on this, is that is way too simplistic to say something like alcohol is more dangerous than marijuana, et cetera. Certainly when it comes to violence, we would agree, alcohol. When it comes to liver damage, we would agree, alcohol. But when it comes to lung damage, when it comes to IQ, no one's brought up the impacts on a country that increases heavy chronic use among young people, which is undoubtedly what commercialization and legalization will do. So when you look at school performance, lung issues, marijuana is worse. When you look at driving, yeah, alcohol triples your risk of a car crash and marijuana doubles it. That doesn't mean that we want to say, well, then we want to encourage you to use marijuana because it doubles it as opposed to triples it. It means we want to discourage the use of both of those substances. And it's too late to try and prohibit alcohol. That's not going to happen. K Street, we look at the alcohol lobby, 7 lobbyists for every member of representatives. Tobacco, with every single anti-tobacco prohibition, short of full prohibition on the books, 1 in 4 Americans still smoke cigarettes. It still kills 480,000 people in the United States, even though I don't even know where you can legally smoke these days. I mean, does anybody know where you can actually? You can't smoke in your own home because you're going to be kicked out by your spouse. So even with that, and it's true that we haven't arrested people for tobacco and we've seen the decline, but we've seen the decline because of the public stigma against tobacco use. The major stigma that all people, even smokers, have disdain for themselves these days and their habit. We have the opposite for marijuana. Tobacco's been legal forever in this country, and we've only seen the reduction in the last 10 to 15 years, even though it's been legal for a while. We've seen the reduction because of the stigma. The problem with legalization and commercialization is it breaks down that stigma, it normalizes use, it commercializes use, and therefore we have the opposite scenario for marijuana, and that's why I think you see the increases.
Thank you, Kevin. I think we want to bring this back here from...
and I'm sorry, I have to leave.
Here from, yes, oh, thank you so much for joining us. I know you have to pull out. Thank you. Michelle and Ruth, we obviously can pull this debate into an exclusively American-centric debate because it is such a fascinating and lively and urgent one. So, and thank you so much for putting the spotlight on there and those in our audience who are experts in this area as well. Let's pull back for a moment and ask Michelle and Ruth to comment to some of these issues on the broader plane.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Steve, also for bringing this to a broader scope, because that's where we, you know, we come in as Global Commission. We certainly don't want to interfere with the internal U.S. debate, and we also don't want the debate to be only about marijuana. Again, from my own perspective, as now the Secretary General's envoy on AIDS in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, my concern is that this is the region of the world where the AIDS epidemic now is growing the fastest, and that's strongly associated with the negative effect of inappropriate drug policies. I'd like to make two comments on the round of questions and comments that came. First, I'd like to acknowledge what you said, sir, on science and evidence base. And I do not think that many countries in the world have really sit down, talked to the science, listened to the evidence, and then based their policies on that evidence. For the first time in Vienna, what happened, and this is to the credit of UNODC and the CND organizers, is that they brought together a number of scientists in the day preceding the CND meeting. Nora Volkoff chaired one of the panels on the state of the art in demand reduction, and I was privileged to chair the second group on the state of the art on harm reduction. And Nora and I could both report to the CND, to the high level segment in the plenary. That, I thought, on the moment had a fairly strong impact, and that was somehow a strong message from the UN that the debates should be based on scientific evidence. But at the end of the day, if you look at the final resolution that came out of Vienna, even the word harm reduction is not mentioned once. So the distance that we still have to cover between what the science tells us and between what is in the policy and then what's actually implemented on the ground is huge. But I do certainly welcome very much your comment. My second point is that I'm not sure I actually understand where Stephen is going. I understand what he says we should not do, not go too much to the left, not go too much to the right. But what is he suggesting? And when he says tobacco, I don't want, the disaster of alcohol and tobacco, my question is then, what is it that he wants? Does he think we should go back to prohibition? I don't think what's going wrong with alcohol is because alcohol is regulated. It's just because regulation is not effective enough and not properly done. But let's think of tobacco. I do agree that there is a stigma now in the public opinion on tobacco that wasn't there 20 years ago, but I would argue that it is actually effective regulation. It is the countries coming together in Geneva and signing a global tobacco framework a few years ago. It is regulation that doesn't allow you to sell tobacco to people below the age of whatever, 16 or 18, depending on countries. It is the possibility now to go to harm reduction and treat your nicotine addiction with e-cigarettes without having the harm of the other substances in cigarettes that actually generate lung cancers. So I think if we have significant results in the fight against tobacco worldwide, it's precisely because it is regulated. And I don't see why we couldn't achieve similar effects, including capturing, as you said, the illegal markets by going to by expanding on regulation on other drugs. So I'm sorry, Stephen has left. I feel uncomfortable, Kevin. You know, talking. Kevin has left. I feel uncomfortable talking about what he said, but I'm not sure I understand where he was going.
Thank you, Ruth.
Thank you. Ambassador, you told before that for 40 years there was a battle between two extremist positions. I do not agree with that, because the hegemonic position was prohibition. The people who were advocating for a regulated market were not really vocal, and they couldn't be heard in the world community. Even your country didn't allow this real discussion between the two extremes, as you call them. And in this sense, what we want is really a debate to take place. That's the first element. The second element is we are not for regulation like this as the solution that we should introduce before Tuesday, you told, before. No, we want to experiment different model of regulation. And possibly, I don't know, possibly the model of Colorado, which is far away from the model of Uruguay, will show some great difficulties, possibly. But the model of Uruguay is perhaps too restrictive. We spoke with the people from Uruguay in Vienna. Each consumer has to be registered. Every plant has to be registered. They invented little
genetic markers
mm-hmm. to know from where the plant is coming. I mean, they are making a real system of control from the isolate plant to the isolate consumers. Perhaps it's too much. Perhaps Colorado is too little control. And perhaps some measures has to be taken, really, also on the level of pricing. For instance, to take another experience, because alcohol is a real problem, we had a huge invasion in Switzerland and in Europe generally with alcopops 15 years ago, I think, or 20 years ago. Alcopops were really made to tease the youth. Huh? Mixture, very soft alcohol. What could we do? We couldn't ban, but we could, with taxes, have the price being so high that no young people could buy it. And it disappeared from the market, mm-hmm. totally. In Switzerland, you cannot buy now this kind of products because they are just not accessible, affordable. I mean, when I saw some picture in Colorado about candies or candies-like products, mm-hmm. I was shocked. Mm-hmm. I think these products must be either banned or have such prices that they are, in any case, not accessible for use. But this is a problem of the regulation. We have to develop different models. For instance, now in Switzerland, many cities are thinking about what is called, it's a too nice a name, cannabis social club with registered consumers and registered farmers to bring it to the customer in a limited quantity. We have to try all that. Having a prescription of heroin is a kind of regulation. We have now medical heroin in Switzerland, mm-hmm. in Germany, in the Netherlands, and so on. It's a kind. It's one model of a regulation of a market, and we could take quite a great number of very addict people off the market. We couldn't eliminate totally the market, but we take the most captive consumers out of the black market. So I think these are, I think it's very important. The fight against the commercialization, as Kevin stressed before, I think is another battle. I mean, it's a battle of civilization. What is Why is big business so important in this country? But it has nothing to do directly with the issue of regulation. Now, I know that we didn't answer this lady. Mm-hmm. And I, if you allow,
please,
just to say, yes, there are crimes linked or difficulties linked with the consumption, like with alcohol. But you will not prohibit alcohol. You will prohibit people to drive when they have alcohol in their blood. I mean, we have to find the same way to avoid crimes made under the influence of a substance as we do with alcohol and other substances.
Thank you. We're getting near to the end of our time. I'd like to turn to Ambassador Brownfield. There was a serious questions around Mexico and the cartels that I think he's best equipped to address. And I'd like to ask him also to offer us some thoughts on obviously any of the other subjects that were raised, including children, which was highlighted in one of the questions, but also looking ahead to 2016 and the UN special session. If you could give us some idea of what are you hoping for? What would be the best outcome of that high-level session at the UN General Assembly in 2016? And then we can close with Michelle and Ruth sharing with us their thoughts on what the best outcome might look like. Ambassador Brownfield, thank you.
Fair enough. And ladies and gentlemen, perish the thought that I would ever take an adversarial posture with the former president of the Swiss Confederation, but I will offer you a fact. In September of 1970, I entered university in the United States of America. The very first individual that I encountered as I was walking into registration was a gentleman who represented an organization called NORML, the National Organization for Reform of Marijuana Laws, and he handed me a flyer and it called for legalization of marijuana. So I repeat, this debate has been going on for more than 40 years. I agree with President Dreyfus that one side was dominating the debate, but you will never convince this boy, at least, that there has not been a fairly emphatic debate on this issue, at least in this country, since September of 1970. May I offer a couple of general observations and then get back to what Steve has suggested. One is the range of questions and our comments demonstrate once again there is not consensus on this issue. I mean, that's the reason why we're having a debate. There are, in fact, a number of models out there, including different models for different countries, which gets to my pillar number three. We have to accept that. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, accepting it does mean some countries are going to take a far more rigid and emphatic approach to this. Countries perhaps feel that they're in the process of an addiction crisis are likely to take a different posture than countries that are not. That is what I mean, at least, when I say pillar number three, we have to tolerate that different countries will pursue different policies. Second, if I might, Mexico itself, and I do agree, I'm one who should respond to the question of Mexico. In some ways, I would suggest that the Mexico that we began to work with in a systematic and a consensus-driven bilateral way in 2006-2007 represented exactly that part of this problem that I think there is consensus that we want to combat and resist, and that is large, enormously powerful, violent criminal organizations who, at least in this instance, had grown to such an extent that in certain areas they represented a challenge to the very authority of the government or the state to control and govern that particular part of Earth, whether it was a town, a city, or a state. And the Mexico effort, as was enshrined in the Merida Initiative, was an effort whereby the United States of America offered $1 for every $13 provided by the government of Mexico to address the problem on four specific points. One was to combat the criminal organizations themselves. That was very law enforcement and security focused. Second was to build stronger institutions, whether law enforcement, prosecutors, courts, correction systems, whatever constitutes eventually the arsenal, the toolbox of the government and the state. Third, to build a more modern and effective border, initially between the United States and Mexico, but as we've moved into the new administration, other borders, such as the southern border of Mexico as well. And fourth and finally, because no one has touched this general issue yet, build stronger communities, economic, social, healthcare, roads, infrastructure, on the logical premise that if you are going to ask a community to resist the efforts of criminal organizations to corrupt their institutions by offering them more money than they might otherwise make, they have to have a reason to see a stake in their own future. Which finally allows me to go to the last of the points before I get to 2016. And that is my complete and utter agreement that while obviously this has become a matter of public health and health care as much as criminal justice, it is not one to the exclusion of the other. And I'm going to offer a very quick and yet personal story to give you some sense of the law of unintended consequences. And I will do this carefully. About a year ago, I was summoned to jury duty, something that I get to do every 2 to 3 years, even in my current position. The trial, it was a criminal trial to which I had been summoned, was a trial against an individual. And the charges against him were attempted homicide, firearms violations, conspiracy to traffic and sell more than 500 kilos of cocaine, and a possession charge. I am pleased to report that due to my position, I was dismissed from jury duty. It seemed that both sides concluded that they did not want me sitting on the jury. I tracked the case just for kicks in the subsequent months. Ladies and gentlemen, the individual was finally convicted. Do you know what he was convicted for? Possession. Why? Because despite the fact that this potential juror saw very good reason to suspect that this guy really was bad news, all of the other charges fell apart due to evidence problems or witnesses that, for whatever reason, could not convince the 12 individuals that were eventually selected for this jury that they were telling the truth. And what did he get nailed for? He got nailed for the simplest charge to make on planet Earth. That they found a quantity of marijuana, I believe it was, although it may have been cocaine, in his physical possession. So this is one of the reasons why a bunch of prosecutors have been pushing back in the United States against some of these proposals to drive down the potential sentences for those who are convicted for these charges, because they say, be careful. At the end of the day, what you may be doing is taking away our last opportunity to at least put some of these people out of circulation for a while, or alternatively, to use the pressure of a larger of a sentence to actually get them to turn on those higher up in the drug trafficking organization. Okay, 2016. We are referring, ladies and gentlemen, to the special session of the UN General Assembly, which has been approved, or a resolution for which was passed last year, to do a special session of the General Assembly on the drug issue and drug policy. Where are we right now? First, I think we actually are in a broader debate and a broader discussion on this issue than we have ever been in the history of this planet. Second, we are still wrestling with where the preparations for this event will be centered. Will they be centered in Vienna, the location of the United Nations specifically designated drug control, drug management agencies? Will they be centered in New York? That's basically the choice. And the thought for New York is that that is where your political leadership is located within the United Nations. My guess is we will eventually, and as usual, split the difference in some way. Some preparations will occur in Vienna. They will then be passed to New York for the political touch-up in terms of what will happen. What will come out of this process? I have laid out for you what I hope will be the overarching umbrella within which we then have this debate. Respect the integrity of the three conventions. permit flexibility of interpretation. I've now acknowledged and recognized that there will be different models and policies pursued by different governments, and finally agree that the actual transnational criminal organizations must still be proscribed by whatever means that the states and the international community can bring to bear. Now, within that, there is plenty of room for debate, and I believe we're hearing much of that debate right here and right now. I welcome it. I am your international operator, for those of you who are citizens of the United States of America. I won't tell you what to decide. I will ask you, please decide something that I actually can deliver in the international community. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you so much. Michelle and Ruth, you have the final words here.
Well, thank you very much. And first, thank you to all of you for attending this session and for your comments. And thank you, Steve, for hosting us today. Thank you, Ambassador Brownfield, for taking part in this discussion. And thank you also, as Ruth said before, for your openness. I also wouldn't, you know, disagree with your four pillars in any way. And I wouldn't wish the audience to think that the Global Commission is coming with a strong request for the renegotiation of the conventions. What I would like to see is, first, in between now and the 2016 session, a debate, but not a debate between, again, preconceived ideologies or points of view, as it's happening too often, but a debate on the evidence and the question at the country, regional, and global level. What we have done, what have we achieved after years of certain policies? And when people one of us in the debate or in the audience was saying earlier, maybe if we were to do that, we could be even getting worse somewhere worse than where we are getting now. My question is, are we really pleased with what we have achieved when, in fact, we failed to reduce drugs and when we have witnessed a huge AIDS, hepatitis C, TB epidemic, huge violence in Latin and Central America, and huge harm? So that's what we call an open debate at the Global Commission, not one more debate of the elites with whatever preconceived ideas they have. And second, when it comes to the outcome, I agree with the pillars you're advocating for, Ambassador Brownfield. I agree that there is a risk with allowing the flexibilities that some countries would actually use the flexibilities to be extremely rigid and to remain rigid. But then I would argue that's not what I want as an outcome. I want an outcome that provides guidance and principles around which countries should review their own policies in the light of what the scientific evidence tells us. And I'm skeptical about Vienna leading on the process when Vienna is even incapable of giving these two words, harm reduction, when we at the Global Commission and we in Europe in general really talk about see harm reduction and the strong incentive to implement harm reduction as a desirable outcome of the 2016 debate. And to us, harm reduction is not only reduction of harm reduction in the 2-3 interventions that prevent HIV or hepatitis C transmission, OST, NSP, ART. It is harm reduction in a broader sense. It is having these policies based on scientific evidence, really reducing the harm to the individual, to the community, to the society of both drug use and of inappropriate drug policies based on aggressive law enforcement, prohibition law enforcement. So in summary, it is going for those flexibilities, but coming out of 2016 with a set of principles and of guidances, just as the WHO, UNODC, and UNAIDS jointly recommend that countries implement a set of harm reduction interventions for medical purposes, I could see a set of similar harm reduction interventions in a broader, again, social, beyond just medical perspective coming out of the debate as strong UN guidance. And then if there is such a guidance, then we will hear anymore, or we shouldn't hear anymore, from countries that would say, we are against methadone because to us methadone in our country is illegal, or we wouldn't hear anymore, I'm sorry to quote a country here, Japan come in Vienna and say, we do not believe in harm reduction. So that's where I see the outcome, a science-driven, evidence-driven debate, and then guidance and principles that would allow people to review their policies and then have them evolve and shift within the flexibilities that you suggest.
Thank you. Ruth, you have the last word.
Thank you. Just two elements to add to Michelle. On one side, I recognize the knowledge accumulated in Vienna and the UNODC, and they will play an important role in the preparation of this special session. But they have focused for so many years mainly on repression, law and order, that they have, in part, and they recognize it themselves, and the director Fedotov had very, very strong words also on that, that the public health and the well-being of the people were partly lost. So, I mean, we have to enlarge the point of view and not only to have UNODC participating in this preparation, but also other agencies of the UN family, WHO, human rights, and many others, development and so on, because they have other experience about the impact of the drug policy in their field of activities. And we want also to have the civil society associated more in the preparation and at the special session. I was in the last one, and the last one finished with a declaration saying a world without drug is possible, no, is our aim, and we can do it. That was for 18 years. So I hope a really realistic view of the topic being developed there in New York at this special session. And I would say the second thing is really one perhaps detail, but I want to add it here. I don't think that we can renegotiate now the conventions. And I agree with you with the fourth principle that we need, and we have another commission on crime also working in Vienna, that we need to coalize all the country in the fight against the globalized organized crime. But I wish something. Evidence-based, the list of substances isn't evidence-based. Having nothing about alcohol and tobacco, but having cannabis among the highest harmful drugs is not evidence-based. The whole 50 years of discussion about substances was so ideological, was so often linked with the consumption of marginal groups in society, of foreigners, of workers, of low-level people, so that the drugs were chosen and put in the scala not for evidence, not for pharmacological evidence, but for social arguments. And this should be renegotiated. And this is very difficult because in the system we had till now, new substances are arriving every week on the market. And we have to review all this list of substances inside the convention because we have a credibility gap, a huge credibility gap when we don't put the real relationship between the different substances. And these differences will allow us to find regulation models, for instance, that will be different for the different substances.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ambassador Brownfield, President Dreyfus, Ambassador Kazakhshin, thank you so much. Please join me.
Thank you to all.
It was a terrific, really terrific session. Thank you so much.
It was so interesting.
We're adjourned.
Really.
Thank you very much.